Good morning, students. Today in this lecture, we will continue our discussion on isomerism in metal complexes. And in the previous two lectures in this series, we have discussed about geometrical isomers. We discussed about different categories of isomerism which are possible in metal complexes. Today we will discuss about the optical isomerism, which is another type of stereoisomerism found very commonly in metal complexes. So, what is optical isomerism? It is also known as mirror image isomerism, and we know that optical isomerism arises due to asymmetry in the molecule. When the molecule has it does not contain any element of symmetry, then what happens in that case, chirality arises, that is handedness. And in that case, molecule can have its mirror image. So another isomer of the molecule is possible. Another type of arrangement of the ions of the atoms around the central metal atom is possible, which is exactly the mirror image of the original complex. So you can say that the original complex, it can exist in the form of its mirror image. So when you put the two optical isomers together and you can imagine a mirror plane between them, this is an imaginary mirror plane, so you can see that the two complexes, they just look like the mirror image of each other. So if you can imagine the group which is near to the mirror appears first in the mirror image. So this B is coming here in the image, and this C is coming like this. So the inverted configuration, or you can say the mirror image, these two isomers, they exist in the form of mirror image. But if you try to put this structure over this structure, they are non-superimposable. So you cannot superimpose this structure over this. So they are what? They are non-equivalent. What happens if you put down the mirror image over the original structure? Then in that case, it should overlap it. It should superimpose the original structure. But if the mirror image cannot superimpose the original structure, you get non-superimposable mirror image. And now what happens due to this the existence of handedness, now the optical isomerism arises. And because our optical isomers, they exist in the form of two mirror images, we also call this as a mirror image isomerism. So this is actually clear from this diagram. This is the complex and this is the mirror image. But actually, if you see, they are what? They are the optical isomers. And they are also known as the enantiomers. So in the case of the optical isomers, each of the isomer is showing the optical activity. Now, what is optical activity? So we know that optical activity is when your molecule is able to rotate the plane of polarized light. When you pass on the plane polarized light, it can either rotate the light to left or right direction. And the two optical isomers, which are able to rotate the light in any of the direction in the equal amount, but in opposite direction. If the complex is rotating in the left direction, then the isomer will rotate in the right direction. So the direction of the rotation will be opposite, but the extent would be the same. The amount of rotation would be the same, but only the sign will change. So you also call them a pair of enantiomers. So enantiomers are basically the optical isomers, which are non-superimposable mirror images of each other. So from the figure, we can see that complex is not superimposable on its mirror image. And the molecules that are not superimposable on their mirror image, we call them chiral molecules. So this phenomena of chirality arises here. And chirality is nothing but presence of asymmetry in the molecule. The reason behind the superimposability is what? It is presence of asymmetric bonding on the central metal atom. And this asymmetry is actually characterized by the attachment of all the four different ligands. For example, A, B, C, and D all are different. Like in the case of organic chemistry, we have seen this phenomena of chirality. And in organic chemistry, we know that the carbon is actually sp3 hybridized, having four valencies, and when all the four valencies they are occupied by four different groups, you say that this carbon atom is chiral. So this generates the center of asymmetry, and now due to the asymmetry that becomes optically active. So you can conclude from this chiral molecules, they do not have a plane of symmetry. Actually, they don't have any element of symmetry. Similar phenomena, this arises in the metal complexes also. If a molecule exists in two isomeric forms, which are mirror images of each other, and they are not superimposable over one other. You are trying to put the mirror image over the original structure, but the exact groups are not coming together. So in that case, you will see that the mirror image cannot superimpose the original structure. And now these two isomers, we call them enantiomers. So when enantiomers, we have an adequate long lifetime so that they can be separated, the phenomena of optical isomerism occurs. Otherwise, if the rotation is possible at the room temperature, then what will happen? They will interconvert into each other, right? And in that case, you won't know that which of the enantiomer is present in the compound. So if any of the isomer, it has a long lifetime and it exists in the mixture for a certain time duration, then you can actually separate them. And both the isomers, they are optical isomers, and they both are optically active. The mere difference between the two isomers is the sign of the rotation. Even the amount of the rotation is same. The extent by which they rotate the plane polarized light, it is same for both the isomers. But the only difference is the sign of rotation. Now the enantiomers, they actually, one of the enantiomers rotate the plane polarized light in one direction, and of course it is by a certain angle, and the other isomer, it rotated in the opposite direction with the same angle. So the isomer that rotate the plane of polarized light towards the right side, that is in the clockwise direction, when it is rotating like this, the right side, you can say that it is a clockwise direction. So you call it a dextrorotatory or D form. And sometimes it is also represented by the plus sign, because you can actually measure the angle in plus. The sign of the angle would be plus. So it is also represented by the plus sign. Then the isomer which rotates the plane of polarized light towards the left side. Towards the left side is this, right? So it is actually the anti-clockwise direction. And it is called as the levorotatory or L form. Now it is represented by minus sign, because when you measure the angle of the rotation, it comes in the minus sign. Both the isomers, they have exactly identical physical and chemical properties. You cannot identify them on the basis of their physical and chemical property. Everything is same. Like we have discussed in the previous lecture, whenever we have stereoisomerism, like this optical isomerism, the mere difference between the two isomers is arrangement of the groups. And even in the case of the geometrical isomerism, which is another category of stereoisomerism, we have seen that the geometrical isomers also differ in their physical and chemical properties. But in case of optical isomerism, the only difference that exists between the two isomers is difference in their optical activity. Otherwise, their physical properties are same, their chemical properties are same, everything is same. Now, what happens when you mix? You know that whenever a molecule is optically active, it can exist in two forms. One is the D form, other is the L form, and they both are rotating the light in the equal amount. However, the sign is different. The angle of rotation is in the different direction, but the amount is similar. So, if you mix exact proportion in 50:50 ratio, if you mix the two enantiomers, the both D and L form of a particular compound, now what will happen when you pass the plane polarized light through the sample? The D form will rotate it in the right direction, and because we also have the L form in the equal amount, so this L form will rotate the light in the left direction. So because the amount of the rotation is similar for both the compounds, and the concentration that we have taken is also same, so there will be rotation of the polarized light in both the direction with an equal amount. So when the light will come out of the sample, you will see no rotation at all, because first it was rotated by the D form in the right direction, then it is rotated by L form in the left direction. So overall, when you count on the net rotation, so it will be zero. So this becomes a racemic mixture. We call the such mixture as racemic mixture. In a racemic mixture, we have both the D form and L form of a compound in the equal amount. So what happens in the racemic mixture? One form rotates the plane of polarized light in one direction, which is balanced by the other form in the opposite direction. So a racemic mixture is optically inactive. It does not show any optical activity. So if your compound is not showing optical activity, even when you know that yes, it is optically active and it is not showing any activity, you can consider that yes, it contains some impurity of another enantiomer, and even it can be a racemic mixture. Then let us see the different type of possibilities in the metal complexes. So the first category that we are going to discuss is optical isomerism in four coordinate complexes. That is when your metal complex has a coordination number 4. So in this case, a metal ion will be attached with 4 ligands, and the first case that we are taking is square planar complex. So in the square planar complex, the coordination number is 4, geometry is square planar, and this is actually characteristic of the platinum, palladium, such type of nickel, such type of metal ions. They are known for their square planar complexes. So in these type of complexes, optical isomerism is not possible. Why? Because you know that the structure is what? The geometry of the complex is square planar. They have a planar geometry. And now what happens? Because of that planar geometry, they will have a plane of symmetry, right? With that plane, if they have a planar structure like this. So you always have this plane with the help of which you can divide the molecule into 2 equal halves. So whenever there is even only one symmetry element is present in the molecule, it will never show optical activity. Optical activity is shown by only those molecules which are completely asymmetric. They do not have any elements of symmetry. So in the square planar complexes, because we have an element of symmetry exist in the molecule, so they do not show optical isomerism. This is the case, they never show optical isomerism. But yes, one exception is present here, and the complex is mentioned, the example that is mentioned here in the slide, you can see that this complex is known to have optical activity, and we can actually resolve the complex into enantiomers. So the complex actually exhibit optical isomerism, and tetrahedral geometry is even not possible in this case. So you can attribute this optical isomerism to the 4 different groups at the corner of the complex. And this is the only known example of a square planar complex which show optical isomerism. So now this is the structure of the complex, right? Now if you look at the structure carefully, this has no plane of symmetry, because in the earlier case, what we were seeing, we were discussing about the square planar structure, right? So if the square planar structure is there, you will always have a plane of symmetry. But in this molecule, in this complex, the geometry is not tetrahedral, yet the structure is not square planar. The planar structure is not there. And therefore, what happens? Due to the non-planar structure, there is no element of symmetry, no plane of symmetry, and hence the molecule become unsymmetrical. And as soon as the unsymmetrical structure came into existence, your molecule will show, it will start showing optical activity. And any optically active molecule, it will always exist in the D and L form. So you can also separate the enantiomers for this complex, the optical isomers of this complex. This is the only known exception for square planar complexes, which has the optical activity. Now, let us discuss the next case when you have a coordination number 4. For CN4, we also have a tetrahedral complexes. And now what happens in the tetrahedral complexes, the only asymmetric tetrahedral molecule which is characterized by the lack of plane of symmetry, M, A, B, C, D, they show the optical isomer. Like in case of the organic compounds, we have seen that when you have a carbon atom at this place and the four corners, you have four different groups, then only your organic molecules become optically active. And you say that, yeah, this is a chiral center. So similarly, in case of the inorganic tetrahedral metal complexes, at the center, you have a metal ion. And on, at the four corners of the tetrahedron, when all the ligands are different, M, A, B, C, D, when all the four ligands are different in the tetrahedral complex, then such complexes are known to have optical activity. For example, one complex of arsenic is shown here, and here you have methyl, ethyl, and another ligand, sulfide, and another ligand attached with the arsenic. So four ligands are different, and now what happens in this case, the complex actually exists in two optical isomers. So even in the case of tetrahedral complexes, if the two ligands are same, then what will happen? Then in that case, the molecule will have a plane of symmetry and the optical activity is not possible in that case. So tetrahedral metal complexes, they show the optical activity when they are having the formula like M, A, B, C, D, when all the four ligands are different at the corners of tetrahedron. Then we also have the tetrahedral complexes of beryllium second, boron third, and zinc two. And they have unsymmetrical bidentate ligands. And they also show the optical isomerism. And again, that is due to presence of asymmetry. So this is one of the example, that is the bisbenzoyl acetonato beryllium second. It's a complex and it is having a tetrahedral structure. However, in the tetrahedral structure, you can not exactly identify the tetrahedral structure because this is a bidentate ligand and bridging also. So the tetrahedral geometry is not there, but yes, the molecule is asymmetric in nature, and this is also an important example of this class. There is no center of symmetry, there is no plane of symmetry, and the mirror images, they are non-superimposable. So for this beryllium second complex, we can identify the presence of optical activity. And because the molecule is optically active, now of course it will have two enantiomers. It will have one D form and another L form. So this D form will rotate the plane polarized light in one direction, and L will rotate it in another direction. Then optical isomerism in the six coordinate complexes, when we have coordination number six, that is when six ligands are attached to the central metal ion. So here the geometry, preferred geometry, like we have discussed in the previous lecture, in the coordination number 6, the preferred geometry is octahedral geometry. And in the octahedral configuration, the 6 coordinate complex requires the existence not only of the geometrical isomerism of the kind, but also of the mirror image isomerism leading to optical activity. So optical activity is very, very common in few octahedral complexes. Let us discuss their cases. So first is the octahedral complex containing only monodentate ligand. Only monodentate ligands are here. That is the case. And what are the possibilities? So we can have M, A2, B2, C2 plus minus N type of complex. Out of the six ligand, we have six valencies. We have three ligands occupying them, and two of each is present. So, the two optical isomers that are possible, you can see here. This is the mirror plane, which you can imagine, and this is the original complex M, M A A B B C C. Everything is adjacent, right? So this is one form, and in another form just opposite to it. So first you have drawn this structure, now draw a mirror plane here. You need to draw a mirror plane, and now you just draw the mirror image of it, right? That is so simple. and how you will draw the mirror image. So the groups which are visible near to the mirror, they will come first in the mirror image. So the B is here, so it will come here first, then C is near to the mirror, so it will come first in the image, and the groups which are away from the mirror plane, now they will always away they will appear away from the mirror plane on the mirror image as well. So the A, they are here, and the rest is the same. So in this manner you can draw the mirror image of the complex. And now you have drawn the two enantiomers. These two enantiomers, they are non superimposable. If you try to put this structure over this, so what will happen, this B will coincide inside with the A, this C will coincide with the A, then this B will coincide with A. So in this manner, the mirror images, they are non-superimposable, and you can say that here the optical isomerism is present, and these are the two optical isomers of the same complex. So example is, we have here one cobalt complex having two ammonia, two fluoro and two nitro groups. Then the second category of such complexes, when we have only monodentate ligand attached, we have M, A, B, C, D, E, F. That is all the monodentate ligands, they are different. We have six different monodentate ligands present in the complex. So only platinum forged complexes of this type are existing. And there are 15 geometrical isomerism, each of which could exist in the DNL form. So this case is also considered for the geometrical isomerism, and each of the geometrical isomer, whatever you take, each of the isomer can exist in DNL form. So how you will draw the DNL form? You will just draw the structure of one form, and then you will imagine a mirror image, and then you will draw the mirror image of that. So when you have drawn the mirror image of the complex, you are actually getting the two forms of the same complex. So if you count on all the possibilities here, we have a total of 15 geometrical isomers, and each of the geometrical isomer is having two optical isomers. So, as a total, you will get 30 optical isomers. So, for one form of this type of complex, when you have platinum attached to pyridine, ammonia, nitro, fluoro, bromo, iodo, this is the case. So, you have taken only one geometrical isomer. So, this is the platinum, fluoro, bromo, iodo, and all the groups are attached like this. Now, you just imagine a mirror image, mirror plane between the two structure. Just imagine a mirror plane, and now just draw the mirror image of this complex. So what you get, you will get exactly the opposite configuration, and now in this manner you have drawn the DNL isomer. So whenever you are drawing the two different optical isomers, it becomes really easy if you can imagine a mirror plane between them. Now discuss another category, that is octahedral complexes, which contain only symmetrical bidentate chelating ligand. So we know that symmetrical means the two atoms of the bidentate ligand which are attaching to the metal atom, they are similar. So they are called as AA type of ligand. And because the coordination number is 6, so you will have three such ligands attached to the metal atom. So if you draw the structure of them, you will have a metal atom at the center, then the three AA are attached to the metal atom like this. This is one of the structures that you get. And now imagine a mirror plane between here and just draw the mirror image of this structure. So the group which is appearing near to the mirror plane will come first. So you are drawing it like this, and then the two vertical lines, they will be same, and the groups which are appearing on the left hand side, they will appear here on the right hand side. So in this manner, the DNL isomer of these type of complexes can be drawn. Here the AA ligand which we are considering, first of all it is symmetrical because both the atoms which are involved in the bonding with metal, they are same. The second thing is they are bidentate, and yes, they are chelating ligand because now a chelate like structure is developed. And this ligand can be a neutral molecule or even it can be a negative ion. So here so many examples are given, like the most common type of symmetrical bidentate ligand is ethylene diamine, which has been taken. So many such complexes. Then another is the oxalate. So these type of ligands, they can attach to a variety of different ligands, and then they can show the optical activity in the metal complexes. So let us take the example of the cobalt complex. We have COEN33+. So it can exist in the two isomers. So how to draw the two isomers of this complex? Just draw the first structure, that is CO. Now NCC. This is the bonding framework of your ligand. Then NNCC, NNCC. So all the atoms which are bonded to the metal atom, they are similar. Now after you have drawn one form, now just imagine a mirror plane and draw the mirror image just opposite to it. The right structure will come in the left and left will come in the right. In this manner you have drawn the D and L form of this complex, and these are what, they are the a pair of two enantiomers showing the optical activity of equal amount but opposite direction. The next case is when you have octahedral complexes which contain monodentate and symmetrical bidentate chelating ligand. So here the ligand is, you also have two monodentate ligand and also you have two symmetrical bidentate chelating ligand. So the formula, that is the MAA twice A2 plus minus N type. So here the AA, it is what, it is symmetrical bidentate chelating ligand, and small a is the monodentate ligand. Now the COEN twice Cl2 plus, this complex has two geometrical isomers and it is also known to have the cis trans isomerism, and this case we have already discussed in the previous lecture. Now in the cis isomer there is no plane of symmetry and therefore it shows the optically active isomerism. Otherwise if you consider the transform of this complex, the transform will have a plane of symmetry, and that is why the trans isomer of this complex does not show any optical activity. Rather, when it is in the cis form is like we have discussed in the previous lecture, when the two monodentate ligand, they are forming an angle of 90 degree between them. You call it what, cis isomer. So you can see that this is the cis isomer of this complex, and you have drawn the structure of it. So these are the two chloro, and on the other side you have two EN, two ethylene diamine here. And the two nitrogen, you can see they are together, and this is one of the cis form. Now just imagine a mirror plane here and draw the mirror image of the complex. So in this manner you get the D cis complex and L cis complex. So both of them are cis, both of them are having an angle of 90 degree between the two chloro. So both are cis isomers, but one is the D and other is the L form, because they are two non-superimposable mirror images. Now the trans isomer, see what is the case. There is a plane of symmetry because one Cl is up, one Cl is down, and two EN's are like this. So it is having a plane of symmetry. And now what happens? Even when a single symmetry element is present in the molecule, it becomes optically inactive. So this optical inactivity arises due to presence of the plane of symmetry, and therefore we see that the trans isomer does not have any you see optical activity. And what do you call such type of isomers? They are called the mesoforms. So you can consider this as a mesoform of this complex. Then you have another category in which the two monodentate ligands are different. In the previous case the two monodentate are same, and now the two monodentate, they are different. So again you have a symmetrical bidentate ligand AA2, and the two other monodentate are different. So these complexes, they also exist in the three forms, out of which two forms are optically active and the third form is inactive. So again you will get a cis isomer and a trans isomer. In the cis isomer the two AB, they are together and having an angle of 90 degree, but in the trans form one A is above, one B is below. So in that case there will be some symmetry element in the molecule, and therefore, it will be optically inactive. So there will be internal racemization. We call it a meso group. So let us see the example taken here is of again a cobalt complex. So we have cobalt and two EN groups. With cobalt, we have two EN groups, and on the other side, when we talk about the monodentate ligand, so we have one ammonia and one chloro. So these are this is what this is cis form of the complex, where your ammonia and chloro, they are together, adjacent to each other. So this is the cis form, but yes, this is known to have asymmetry, and now this is the D form of the complex. Imagine a mirror plane here and draw the mirror image. So you will get the L form of this complex. So these are the two optically active isomers of this complex. And if you talk about the trans isomer, so in that case, the optical isomerism does not exist. Then the third category is when you have only one symmetrical bidentate ligand AA, and the other two ligands, they are actually A2 and B2. So the other two different ligands, each of them is present in two numbers. So it becomes MAA, A2, B2 plus minus N type. And these complexes, they also exist in the three forms, out of which the two forms are optically active and the third form is inactive. So again, this is the case when you have a cis and trans isomerism in such type of complexes. Geometrical isomerism exists, and again, because the trans form, it has a symmetry elements, therefore you cannot see the optical isomerism in them. The optical isomerism is the case of the cis isomers. So the example is you have a cobalt complex in which you have one oxalate, two ammonia and two nitro. So two ammonia and two nitro, their relative configuration will be indicated, and you will get a cis and a trans isomer. So out of that, just take the cis isomer and now draw the mirror image of it. So the two isomers that you will get in, they are the optical isomers. You have a D cis form of this complex and a L cis form of this complex. Now, in another case, when you have a trans isomer, so this is one of the oxalate you have, and the two ammonia and two chloro. So this is the trans form, and this is the meso form, because if you can see it carefully, this is the plane. This is the plane by which you can divide the molecule into two equal halves. So whenever you have a plane of symmetry or any other element of the symmetry, then what will happen? The molecule will lose chirality. The chirality is actually property due to asymmetry of the molecule. Whenever the symmetry came, the molecule will lose the optical activity. Then we have another category of the complexes when we have octahedral complexes containing optically active ligand. So it is not the structure, rather the ligand that is imparting the optical activity. So we have 1,2-diaminopropane. PN is 1,2-diaminopropane, and it is unsymmetrical bidentate ligand. The complex COEN-PN-NO2 twice. We have one ethylene diamine, one diaminopropane and two nitro groups present here. So these two are the bidentate ligand, EN and PN, and we have two monodentate. So overall you have a 6 coordination number, and this will be an octahedral complex. So this complex can form the two cis and two trans isomers. Four geometrical isomers are possible for this complex, and both the cis forms. Because in the cis form, we have two groups adjacent to each other, right? So that actually imparts the asymmetry to the molecule when the two similar groups are only at one place. So it will be imparting the asymmetry. So both the cis forms of this complex, they have two optical isomers each. Let us see the cis form of this complex. You have D cis, COENPNNO2 twice. This is the cobalt, and you have CO, and you have this is the cobalt molecule, central metal ion, and you have ethylene diamine and one PN. This is PN, ethylene diamine, and two nitro you have. So these two nitro, they are close to each other, right? So they are forming an angle of 90 degrees, and you can consider this as the cis form. So this form of the complex is actually optically active. Now what happens, now you can see that if you divide it by like this, in any of the direction, if you draw a plane, you cannot divide this molecule into two equal halves. So it will have a center of asymmetry. And now what happens, this type of structure can exist in another type of mirror image, which is non-superimposable to it. So you just imagine a mirror plane here, and draw the mirror image of this complex, and you will get another form, another optical isomerism. So in this manner, you can draw the D and L isomers of this cis complex. So this is the cis complex for another type of cis isomer. like I told you, this molecule exists in two cis forms. This is the one cis form and this is the second cis form of the molecule. Then we have another category when the octahedral complexes, they contain the polydentate ligand. So when the polydentate ligand is present, like the case of ethylene diamine tetraacetate, this type of ligand, this is a hexadentate ligand. And when the complex is formed, like cobalt EDTA complex, it exists in the two optical isomers, D and L form. Let us see the structure. So these are the structures we have, because the ligand is what? Hexadentate in nature. So we have only one EDTA here. And this EDTA has completely surrounded the cobalt atom. In the D form, you can see this is the common structure that we can draw, and in the L form, we are just drawing the mirror image of the structure. So this type of complex also exists in the D and L form. Now, let us see how to identify what is the maximum number of enantiomeric pairs which can exist in different complexes, how we can do that. So due to the various geometries in the metal complexes and a wide variety of ligands, you cannot deal with all the complexes. You cannot understand the optical activity of all of them. However, you can just simplify, you can generalize their formula and divide them in few categories. And then you can count on the number of enantiomeric pairs. So let us see the cases. Like we have Ma4 here. The geometry is tetrahedral and you cannot have any enantiomeric pairs because all the ligands are same. All the ligands are of A category. So when all the ligands are same, there will be element of symmetry and now you cannot have optical isomerism. Then MABCD, when you have this type of formula, then you will have one enantiomeric pair in the molecule. MA4 in the square planar structure, you don't have any optical isomerism. Then let us look at all these complexes. Because they are square planar in nature, they do not show any enantiomeric pairs, right? Like MA4, MA3B, whatever be the ligand combination, if the geometry is square planar, these type of complexes, they will never show optical activity. So you have MA4, MA3B, MA2B2, MA2BC, MABCD, none of them is showing the optical activity. And the simple reason is the square planar structure of the complex. And again, in the case of even the octahedral complexes, you have MA2AA twice, you have no optical activity, MAB twice, no optical activity, M2A2B4, no optical activity. And the case of octahedral complexes even, when you have MA6, there is symmetry, very much symmetrical structure and no optical activity, then MA5B, A4B, so till here, till at this place. A4BC, the complexes, they are not showing the optical activity. But as soon as this structure comes here, MA3 and the rest of the three ligands are different. So half of the structure will be containing asymmetry, right? So now you can see that the molecule, the complex here will show one enantiomeric pairs. Then MA2BCDE. As you will increase the number of different ligands, you will see that the optical activity come into existence because now the symmetry is asymmetry is increasing in the structure. So MA2BCDE, it has six enantiomeric pairs. Then MABCDEF, all the six ligands are different in the octahedral complex. So you get 15 enantiomeric pairs. And in the MA2B2C2 type of complexes, you will have one enantiomeric pairs exist for the molecule. Then let us see how to resolve the racemic mixture. So like we have discussed that when you have the D and L form of a complex present in the equal amount in 50:50 ratio, in that case, it does not show any optical activity. And that is due to the internal compensation provided by D and L forms. So a mixture of D and L isomers in the equal proportion is known as racemic mixture. And a racemic mixture is, as you know, that it is optically inactive. So when you try to separate the two different enantiomers from a racemic mixture, this process is called resolution. resolution is you are separating the two enantiomers, the D and L form, from the racemic mixture. And the process is called resolution. So what is resolution? Separation of racemic mixture into its enantiomeric components, D and L form. And you call it resolution. So since D and L form, they have same physical and chemical property. How will you do that? How will you perform the separation? They cannot be separated by ordinary methods like fractional crystallization, fractional distillation. You cannot perform the ordinary methods. Rather, you require some special technique. So now, what type of techniques are employed? So we can use the enzymes. Like we can see that the D and L form, they can have different biological activity. For one form, you can see that it is biologically active and other form is biologically inactive. So now you can differentiate the pair of enantiomers on the basis of their biological activity. Similarly, that type of orientation actually also creates a difference when you use certain chromatographic column, and the difference in the binding capacity exists just due to the difference in the D and L form. So we can use enzyme, we can use chromatography, and in this manner we can separate the enantiomers from their racemic mixture. Now, diastereomers, they are also optically active isomers, but they are not enantiomers, but they are not mirror image of each other. So the cis and trans isomers, they are actually the diastereomers. They are stereoisomers, but not the mirror image of each other. So an important method in the resolution of racemic mixture is using the formation of diastereomers. So now this becomes a very significant discovery, that you are converting the enantiomer into a diastereomer. And then, because the diastereomers are different in their physical and chemical properties, now you are able to separate them. So for example, let us see if the enantiomers are now keep this in your mind. Enantiomers are the optically active isomers. So suppose if you have enantiomers of D and L mixture, they are acidic in nature. You have a racemic mixture, both the D and L form, they are acidic. Now they give salt upon the treatment with optically active base. If you treat the racemic mixture with some optically active base, what will you get? Because both are acidic in nature, you will get a salt. Now, in the same way, both the basic enantiomers of a racemic mixture give salt upon the reaction with optically active acid. So the reverse of this reaction is also possible. And the reaction with the optically active acid or base, whatever you are using according to the nature of your enantiomers, they are required to give two diastereomers salt. Now, you can separate the diastereomers after the salt formation. You can separate the different salts. Because they are the diastereomers, they will have different melting point, or they will have, you can separate them by the fractional crystallization. You can separate them on the basis of difference in their solubility in water. Now, when you have separated them, you can regenerate your original optically active enantiomer. So the separated salts are treated with the optically active material, and now your optically active D and L forms are generated. So in this manner, we have separated the two enantiomers, the D and L form, from a racemic mixture. Even when they do not have any difference in their physical and chemical property, we can convert them into diastereomers, and then we can separate them. For example, resolution of D cis cobalt EN thrice and L cis cobalt EN thrice, these two complexes. When they are present in the racemic mixture, the two D and L form, they are present together, then you just treat the racemic mixture with an optically active D tartaric acid. Now what happens, because the D tartaric acid is used here, so the chloride ions of the complex, they are replaced by the D tartaric ion to give the two diastereomers. Like you can see the reaction, you have both D and L form in the mixture, and this is your complex when you are treating it with D tartaric acid. So the two chloro ions are replaced, and you have D tart minus 2 in the place of 2 chloro. And now, because your tartaric acid is what it is, optically active, now you will get two diastereomers. Now, upon the crystallization, the D form separates in the large crystals, and due to the higher solubility, the L isomer, it remains in the solution. So in this manner, you can separate the two different D and L form of this type of complex. So this process is what it is called a resolution. Now after the separation, a treatment with concentrated hydrochloric acid. Now you have to obtain the original enantiomer. So you treat the salt with a concentrated hydrochloric acid, and now the D and L chlorocomplexes, they are regenerated that is mentioned in the reaction. So this is the D tartaric complex, and HCl is added, so you get the D tartaric acid separated from the complex, and the original D form is isolated, and then L form, L cis form is also regenerated by the treatment of HCl. So in this manner, numerous resolving agents can be used. Like we can use antimonyl tartrate ion and D-alpha bromo camphor bisulfonate anion for the cationic complex, for those complexes which have positive charges on them. The resolving agent used for the anionic complexes obtained from the bases, like we can use the brucine, strychnine, these type of bases can be used. Methods that are more sophisticated, they are required for the resolution of neutral complexes. The neutral complexes can be resolved by the preferential adsorption on the quartz or sugar or extraction using asymmetric solvent. Because in that case, you cannot perform the acid-base reaction. So for the neutral complex, we can use their preferential adsorption on the different type of columns. So we are using the technique of chromatography in this case. And also, we can use here a very advanced technique of gas chromatography, in which we can use the capillary which is packed with a solvent. So we call them Golay solvents. So now I have a few questions for you from this lecture. So you have to identify the complex ion showing the geometrical isomerism here. Then the complexes of the two types which are mentioned. Now you have to identify the type of isomerism between them. A few questions are also from the previous lecture. And again, you have the complexes, two different complexes. You have to identify what type of isomerism is present in them. And then the fourth question, again, the two isomers are given. And this case was very specifically discussed in the previous lecture. One violet and one green isomer. So what type of isomerism we found in these two isomers? We have to solve these questions, and when you will again go through the lecture for solving these questions, your concepts will be more and more clear. So these are the references for today's lecture, and that is all from my side for today. Thank you so much.